Set the scene first, yeah. They burn fast, or at least they do the way that I burn them. It smells so good. Okay. Sorry. As opposed to me just like scratching the book here for myself, for my own selfish pleasure. If you'll see this book, the filigree design on the back of it as well. And there's a stag down here at the bottom, and there's a plane flying over my head right now. So if you can hear that, I'm very sorry. Anyways, these are all vines. And there's a stag at the bottom, and a block of wood with an axe in it. It's the same thing that's on the front. There's the stag. Lived a man and his wife who had long wished for a child, but in vain. Now there was at the back of their house a little window which overlooked a beautiful garden full of the finest vegetables and flowers, but there was a high wall all around it, and no one ventured into it, for it belonged to a witch of great might, and of whom all the world was afraid. One day when the wife was standing at the window, looking into the garden, she saw a bed filled with the finest rampion, and it looked so fresh and green that she began to wish for some, and at length she longed for it greatly. What is the matter, dear wife? Oh, answered she, I shall die unless I can have some of that rampion to eat that grows in the garden at the back of our house. The man, who loved her very much, thought to himself, rather than lose my wife, I will get some rampion, cost what it will. So in the twilight, he climbed over the wall into the witch's garden, plucked hastily a handful of rampion, and brought it to his wife. She made a salad of it at once, and ate of it to her heart's content. But she liked it so much, and it tasted so good, that the next day she longed for it thrice as much as she had done before. If she was to have any rest, the man must climb over the wall once more. So he went into the twilight again, and as he was climbing back, he saw, all at once, the witch standing before him, and was terribly frightened, as she cried with angry eyes, "How dare you climb over into my garden like a thief and steal my rampion? It shall be the worse for you." "Oh," answered he, "be merciful rather than just. I have only done it through necessity, for my wife saw your rampion out of the window, and she became possessed with so great a longing that she would have died if she could not have had some to eat."
Oh no, I've lost my place. There we go.
As you can see, there's an illustration, a sideways illustration, of the man being confronted by the witch. Then the witch said, "If it is all as you say, you may have as much rampion as you like, on one condition. The child that will come into the world must be given to me. It shall go well with the child, and I will care for it like a mother." In his distress of mind, the man promised everything, and when the time came when the child was born, the witch appeared, and giving the child the name of Rapunzel, which is the same as rampion, she took it away with her. Rapunzel was the most beautiful child in the world. When she was 12 years old, the witch shut her up in a tower in the midst of a wood, and it had neither steps nor door, only a small window above. When the witch wished to be let in, she would stand below and would cry, "Rapunzel, Rapunzel, let down your hair." Rapunzel had beautiful long hair that shone like gold. When she heard the voice of the witch, she would undo the fastening of the upper window, unbind the plaits in her hair, and let it down 20 ells below, and the witch would climb up by it. After they had lived thus a few years, it happened that as the king's son was riding through the wood, he came to the tower, and as he drew near, he heard a voice singing so sweetly that he stood still and listened. It was Rapunzel, in her loneliness, trying to pass away the time with sweet songs. The king's son wished to go in to her, and sought to find a door in the tower, but there was none. So he rode home, but the song had entered into his heart, and every day he went into the wood and listened to it. Once, as he was standing there under a tree, he saw the witch come up and listened while she called out, "Oh, Rapunzel, Rapunzel, let down your hair." Then he saw how Rapunzel let down her long tresses, and how the witch climbed up by them and went into her, and he said to himself, "Since that is the ladder, I will climb it and seek my fortune." And the next day, as soon as it began to grow dusk, he went to the tower and cried, "Oh, Rapunzel, Rapunzel, let down your hair." And she let down her hair, and the king's son climbed up by it. Rapunzel was greatly terrified when she saw that a man had come into her, for she had never seen one before. But the king's son began speaking so kindly to her, and told her how her singing had entered into his heart, so that he could have no peace until he had seen her himself. Then Rapunzel forgot her terror, and when she asked her to take him for her husband, she saw that he was young and beautiful. She thought to herself, "I certainly like him much better than old Mother Gothel." Here's the witch climbing up to Rapunzel. And she put her hand into his, saying, "I would willingly go with you, but I do not know how I shall get out. When you come, bring each time a silken rope, and I will make a ladder, and when it is quite ready, I will get down by it out of the tower, and you shall witch knew nothing of all this until once Rapunzel said to her unwittingly, "Mother Gothel, how is it that you climb up here so slowly, and the king's son is with me in a moment?" "Oh, wicked child," cried the witch, "what is this I hear? I thought I had hidden you from all the world, and you have betrayed me." In her anger, she seized Rapunzel by her beautiful hair, struck her several times with her left hand, and then grasping a pair of shears in her right, snip, snip, the beautiful locks lay in the ground, and she was so hard-hearted that she took Rapunzel and put her in a waste and desert place, where she lived in great woe and misery. The same day on which she took Rapunzel away, she went back to the tower in the evening, and made fast the severed locks of hair to the window hasp, and the king's son came and cried, "Rapunzel, Rapunzel, let down your hair." Then she let the hair down, and the king's son climbed up, but instead of his dearest Rapunzel, he found the witch looking at him with wicked, glittering eyes. "Aha!" she cried, mocking him. "You came for your darling, but the sweet bird sits no longer in the nest and sings no more. The cat has got her and will scratch out your eyes as well. Rapunzel is lost to you. You will see her no more." The king's son was beside himself with grief, and in his agony, he sprang from the tower. He escaped with life, but the thorns on which he fell put out his eyes. Then he wandered blind through the wood, eating nothing but roots and berries, and doing nothing but lament and weep for the loss of his dearest wife. So he wandered several years in his misery, until at last he came to the desert place where Rapunzel lived with her twin children that she had born, a boy and a girl. At first he heard a voice that he thought he knew, and when he reached the place from which it seemed to come, Rapunzel knew him, and fell on his neck and wept. And when her tears touched his eyes, they became clear again, and he could see with them as well as ever.